Hello and welcome to Devil's Advocate, the interim report of the Veerappa Moily Oversight Committee looking into reservations for OBCs in higher education was recently presented to the government, and not surprisingly, its recommendations have created quite a stir. Here to talk about them is the chairman of the Oversight Committee, Veerappa Moily. Mr. Moily, let's start with the issue that is most in the news. Now that you've received the interim reports of all the five different subgroups, do you believe that it's possible to increase the intake by 54% at one go next year? Or do you believe it needs to be staggered over a given period of time?
These are all the problems which have been posed by all the subgroups. They said, you know, with the kind of mindset, you know, they are in, they said it is not possible to implement it in one go. It has to be phased over.
So what is your opinion as chairman of the Oversight Committee?
That's why I wanted to know problems with them. Then, you know, they have sorted the problems. I given the answers. And I said, you know, the funding is concerned, yes, it will be met. The infrastructure and also the faculty is concerned. I said, yes, we will go in for the innovative methods.
Can I interrupt? You just said that every one of the five subgroups has actually asked for a period of time. Not one of them is in favor of implementing the increase in intake at one go. So when you ask the subgroups that you want to know their problems, are you asking their problems so that you can persuade them to agree to doing it at one go? Or are you asking their problems so that it helps you agree to what they want? Which is it?
There is no question of bulldozing the implementation of 54%. We are clear about it. But at the same time, there are certain concerns and the problems will have to be addressed. We have been more proactive on that. We said these are all the innovative methods. These are all the, you know, the infrastructure which could be lined up. These are all the funds, unprecedented flow of fund which will be made available.
You said
with that, I would like them to examine, give them the detailed project report. Thereafter, I will examine institution wise and decide whether they can go one go or in phase.
So in other words, what you're doing is you're saying to them, I'll make the funds and the resources available. Once again, think about your position.
Yes.
But if they come back in their final report and stick to what they've said in their interim report, and you then discover that all five subgroups still want a given period of time and none is in favor of implementing it immediately, then will you accept that phasing is inevitable?
You know, they may not come with the same views.
How do you know?
I know it because, you know, I have talked to a number of chairmen of the expert.
Can I interrupt you? Let me quote to you what the Central Universities Group has said on page 7 of their interim report. The expansion of capacity by 54% in one spurt would be neither feasible nor desirable. Now, clearly, a group that says that it's neither feasible nor desirable is not going to change its mind. They're going to stick to their position. And remember, the central universities are not asking for 1 or 2 years. They want a period between 3 and 5 years. And then let me add to that, Dr. Samuel Paul, the head of the management group, told the Times of India on the 29th of July, we have reached a conclusion that in the first year, the total expansion of the 6 IIMs can only be 25%. And remember, in their interim report, the management group has asked not for 1, 2, or 3 years, but for an unspecified period of a few years. How will you persuade these people that they can do it at one go?
No, I'm not going to persuade. I'm going to deliberate on them. That is why after I receive the final reports from all these groups, by 15th of this month, I called for a series of meetings with the individual institutions, the governing council chairmen, and, you know, apex council chairmen. I'm going to discuss with threadbare, you know, because I know the impossibilities.
I understand.
Yeah.
It's always sensible to discuss things threadbare.
Yes.
But let me point out that the year-wise phasing of expenditure, which is an annexure in your own interim report, it makes clear that the total sum of 16,653 crores, which is what you envisage, is in fact to be phased over 5 years, and only 25% of that money is forthcoming in year one. So your own financial planning suggests that in fact the increase in intake will not happen at one go, it will be phased in over 5 years.
You know, that need not be connected with the phasing over. That is the spread over for the 11th 5-year plan. 11th file. Suppose, you know, they are capable of spending earlier, I don't think, you know, the government will hesitate to release that kind of a funding.
If the government is capable of releasing the funding earlier, the government may release it.
Yes.
But more to the point, if your subgroups are not prepared to increase the intake earlier, your planning caters for that. Your planning gives them up to 5 years to do it, depending upon what the final judgment is. You agree with that?
Yeah, correct.
Let me point out one other thing. Your interim report says that expansion, inclusion, and excellence are the moving spirit behind the new reservation policy. If you don't stagger the increase, you will either damage excellence, or worse still, you may end up destroying it. That's why agreeing to the subgroups and staggering as they want is essential.
No, again, I'm coming back to, you know, the question is, you know, it is just like, you know, when we are so small kids, we used to run after the sky to capture the sky, which is beyond the, you know, hill. Then, you know, as you went proceed, you know, the sky is still far away. It is just like that. It is a question of mindset. Once the mindset is changed, because that may be changed, you know, by altered
but
way,
but
because
I'm interrupting you for
provision which you are making.
I'm interrupting you so that we can have clarity. In the beginning of this interview, you seem to suggest that you had an open mind about staggering.
It is true.
You still have an open mind.
Yeah, yeah.
That you will try and persuade the subgroups to change their position, but if they don't, and if they insist on sticking to their request for extra time, then you will agree to extra time and you will endorse their demand for staggering. That is still your position, isn't it?
No, the question is slight amendment. You know, I do stand that I have an open mind. Another point will be that, you know, with the kind of proactive, you know, the approach of the oversight committee or the government on the question of infrastructure, the faculty, and also the funding, may be possible that, you know, these institutions would have changed their mind.
And if they don't change their mind, if the subgroups come
back, I'm not going to persuade.
You won't persuade?
No.
So
because, you know, I want this expansion, inclusion, and excellence, all the three objectives.
You've said a very important thing.
Yes.
You will not get them to change their mind. So if they come back with their original position as expressed in the interim report, then at that stage, the oversight committee will accept that staggering is inevitable.
There are two things. One, taking their, you know, the final report on the face value. The another point is, you know, the brainstorming session, which I will have as an interaction, and critical examination of each and every problem which will be posed by each of the institutions.
I fully understand that.
Thereafter, I'm even outside these groups, outside our oversight committee, I'm going to invite on 28th and 29th all the experts all over the country.
I fully understand.
Put them around and say, what should be the approach.
But suppose at the end of that process, you find that the subgroups have not changed their position, and I've quoted to you to show how emphatically they hold their views, and suppose at the end of all your wider consultations, people also say to you, staggering is sensible, then at that stage, will you accept that staggering is inevitable?
No, that is for the oversight committee to take a holistic approach. But one thing I must tell you, that we will have a holistic approach. The idea is that, you know, prepare a comprehensive roadmap to achieve the ultimate
objective. Let me point something else out to you. Newspaper reports, in particular in the Business Standard, on the 28th of July and the 3rd of August, are already saying that it is likely that you will split the 54% overall increase into two slabs of 27 each, which would be, in fact, 13.5 for the OBCs and 13.5 for the protection of the reserve category, split into two, and that you'll do it in two stages, perhaps over 2 years. You haven't denied those reports. They've been in the papers for at least,
you know,
a week to 2 weeks.
As I've already told you, that it is an open-ended decision. I will take this decision with the oversight committee only in the final report.
Okay,
that
so
is why I'm waiting, keeping my mind open, this side or that side, both channels.
So when you
open.
Say your mind is open, this side or that side, it could go either way. It's 50-50.
Depending upon the detailed project report submitted by each institute.
Quite right, but it is at the moment 50-50. It could go either way.
No, it may depend upon the institution.
Quite right. But
some institutions may come forward and say, with the kind of the, you know, the proposal which is made by the oversight committee, we can go in one way. It is likely to happen. And some institutions will say it is impossible, even if all the facilities are lined up.
Quite right. So you will happen. So you will allow individual institutions to decide.
Yes.
Those that can do it at one go next year will do it.
Very
Those that want extra time will be given the extra time if they are determined they need it. Is that right?
Yeah, correct. Very
okay.
Very
then let me put this to you. Many members of your oversight committee, in particular Balchandra Mungekar and Sukhdev Thorat, one is a member of the Planning Commission, the other is the chairman of the UGC, believe that actually this question of staggering is beyond the remit of the oversight committee. They think that you are overextending yourself by even entertaining the possibility of staggering the increase. What do you say to them?
That is their personal opinion. I don't think the personal opinion will have a overarching, you know, the influence over the entire committee. The oversight committee consists of many people, and you know, the views of everybody will be taken into consideration. Ultimately, the main theme of not disturbing the excellence will prevail all over the institution.
That's the main theme.
Yes.
Not disturbing excellence is the main theme.
Very
Everything else is subordinate.
Everything else, you know, but each one is important,
okay.
You know. Because after all, the expansion we'll have to go.
Quite right.
What
but
I'm telling you
but the main theme is not disturbing excellence.
Yes, very much.
Let's take a break at that point. We've spent a lot of time in part one talking about the question whether the 54% increase can happen at one go next year or whether it needs to be staggered over a period of 2 and 5 years. And let's in part two talk about two other contentious issues. How you handle what's called the creamy layer and what the cutoff point will be. We'll be back in a moment's time to continue this discussion. See you after the break. Welcome back to Devil's Advocate and an exclusive interview with the chairman of the Oversight Committee, Veerappa Moily. Mr. Moily, in part one, we talked about the issue of implementation of the 54% increase and whether it can happen at one go or it needs to be staggered. Let's turn to a second contentious issue, which is how you deal with what's called the so-called creamy layer. Now, in employment, the creamy layer of the OBCs are excluded from reservations. Should they be similarly excluded in terms of education?
It's a question, it's a debatable point. That is why, you know, that question I have not decided in the interim report. I kept it for the final report.
Your interim report says the issue concerning the creamy layer is being considered by the committee.
Yes.
And a view will be taken in the final report.
Very
what true. Steps are you taking to consider it? How are you considering it?
It is a question of design of implementation of the reservation order. There are two debates. One, they say, you know, insofar as the education is concerned, creamy layer should not be implemented because, you know, you cannot capture the entire backward class.
And the other one?
Other one is they say that, you know, if the creamy layer is not included, then, you know, the people who are mighty, people who are rich and their children, they will knock away the entire lot of the reservation.
Is this debate happening at the level of your oversight committee?
Yes.
It's an active debate.
This is at the level of the oversight committee. It is debated all over the country and every part of the corner of the
country. Well, of course, how the country debates it is another matter. It's the Oversight Committee I'm concerned about. Is it within the remit of the Oversight Committee to consider whether the creamy layer should be included or excluded? I ask you this because the terms of reference as laid out in your order of May 29, which set up the Oversight Committee, make no reference to this whatsoever.
Not necessary. You know, after all, the policy of implementation within the jurisdiction of the oversight committee. So we are taking the design of implementation into this, and the creamy layer is one of the component of the implementation process
and
implementation design.
So what you've done is you have yourself decided that this subject is subsumed under your remit and therefore you have a right to look at it.
Yes.
The problem is that perhaps as many as 5 members of your oversight committee seem to disagree. Again, Mr. Balchandra Mungekar, Mr. Sukhdev Thorat, in this instance, I'm told, even the Education Secretary, Mr. Sandeep Banerjee, and perhaps 2 other people, making a total of 5, believe that this is not a subject for the Oversight Committee to be looking into.
It is for them to raise the issue, deliberate it in the Oversight Committee, instead of voicing it personally in the press. Outside.
Ah, in other words, you're saying if they have differences, they should keep quiet about it, discuss it internally, not go public.
Better.
You resent them going public.
It's not appropriate, that's all.
It's not appropriate. You know, of course, that Mr. Balchandra Mungekar has actually written you a formal letter disagreeing with your views and, I believe, recording his dissent with your opinion that the final report will decide what happens to the creamy layer.
I think keeping open any issue, you know, is not an offense. and it can be taken up in the final meeting. I think whatever the views members have, you know, they can raise it in the meeting.
So you're saying to these so-called dissenting members, keep an open mind, don't judge the issue in advance, let the debate happen first.
I must be frank enough to say to you that, you know, there was no dissent. The opinion was a consensus, total consensus in the interim report. I hope that, you know, similar thing will happen in the
final. Can I interrupt and say that some of these dissenting members claim that they weren't shown the final draft of the interim report before it was sent to the
Once it is approved by the committee, you know, the usual practice is it is not shown again to each member. That means you must have another meeting.
Let me raise a third issue that is becoming contentious. It is, in fact, your recommendation that the cutoff mark for OBCs in central universities should be somewhere midway between those for the SC-ST and the unreserved category. Why is it not at the same level as the SC-ST? Why are you putting it midway, i.e. higher?
No, OBCs are not equivalent to the SC-ST.
Many OBCs disagree. Yeah. They say that the disadvantages they've suffered is the same.
Agreeing or not, it is not the question. You know, for example, you go.
So you've decided the issue already that they are not at the same level.
No, not I have decided. It is decided by the interim, in the interim report, by the oversight committee.
But is the oversight committee united in deciding this, or do they have differences which you've papered over?
No. It is a question of not. You know, the after all, you know, these decisions are taken by this oversight committee. You know, in that, when we decided, you know, there was no such.
Let me point out to you what could be a problem with this particular decision, which puts the cutoff mark midway between. In the case of the IIMs, IITs, and AIMS, in fact, what you've recommended is that the threshold for admission should be determined by the respective institutions alone, commensurate with the level of excellence they enjoy, which means that these institutions could choose to put the cutoff mark so high that it is only just below the unreserved category.
Yes.
They could do that.
It is left to them, because as it is done by them. It is now even the IIMs, IITs, and all the AMs, these institutions, you know, they have decided their own, you know, midway cutoff.
Can I interrupt?
Threshold mark between the SCST and the
quite
general.
Right, but I'm
now,
not
having done so, we are also giving back the decision only to them.
Quite right. And because you've allowed the IIMs, IITs, and AIMS to cut their threshold mark as high as they want, and then add to that, and this is very important, add to that the recommendation of the management subgroup, which says there must be no unjustifiable demand on the institutes to lower admission standards. This means that if these groups set their standards and set their cutoff mark unreasonably or unfairly high, you can't put pressure to bring it down.
No, interim report itself makes it very clear, you know, threshold mark will be fixed by the individual.
And you won't put pressure to bring it down?
No.
So if they put it high, even if other people think it's unreasonably high, you still have to accept it.
To be very frank with you, it is working very well with regard to the SCST reservation is already with those institutions.
Let me put this to you.
Yes.
Let me ask you a blunt question. Given the sort of terms and conditions for reservations that your interim group has accepted for the IITs, IIMs, and AIMS, how many OBCs do you think will actually be able to benefit from reservations? Because you've allowed these organizations to set the cutoff mark as they want, you've also given them the power to undermine OBC reservations as a result. That's the problem.
Just ground realities are available. For example, the SCST threshold has been fixed. Do you think that, you know, SCST did not join at all? I got information from IITs. I must tell you, SCST, they are admitted in full in all the IITs.
But the difference between the SCST cutoff level and the cutoff level for OBCs at IITs and IIMs could be huge, because the cutoff level for OBCs at IITs and IIMs may be just below the unreserved category. In other words, it may be too high for most OBCs, and you've accepted that there's nothing you can do. That's the problem.
No, it is not the question of nothing to do with the question. If you know this,
you're saying this is the reality.
This is the reality. You know, you must know what is happening in Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. The difference between the general category and the OBC is not even 0.3%.
Yeah, but
sometimes, you know,
what applies,
it may be 2%.
But what applies to Tamil Nadu and Karnataka may not apply to Bihar and Orissa or UP.
The idea is, you know, it's not to degrade this institution, to enable the OBC students to get in. I want these OBC students, SCST students, you know, to go to the institution which has an enhanced prestige, which has to, because after all,
you know, can I interrupt?
You know, listening, this is listening in their interest.
Listening to you say that the idea is not to degrade the institution.
Yes.
Earlier in part one, you said excellence was the main thing.
Yes.
Yes. You know what I get? I get the feeling that of the three elements that you described as the moving spirit, expansion, inclusion, and excellence,
yes,
expansion and inclusion have been subordinated to excellence.
No, to be very frank
quite
with you,
clearly.
Yes, you have been telling that, you know, I don't want to compromise on excellence. While doing so, we don't want to negotiate with the question of expansion. We don't
but
want to
have.
Negotiate with regard to the
but you have.
Inclusion.
You see, whether we talk
that
about...
That can be, all the three could be built into the whole fabric of
but whether we talk about
knowledge society.
Whether we talk about staggering, whether we talk about the exclusion of the creamy layer, whether we talk about the cutoff point.
Yes.
You could end up as an oversight committee making recommendations which actually substantially dilute the government's original commitment. That is the problem staring people in the face. That's why Mr. Mungekar and Mr. Thorat are deeply concerned.
But I must tell you that we are not going to negotiate on implementation of the reservation policy.
Then can I interrupt and ask you one
yes,
quick question?
Yes, please ask.
Are you scared, given the thrust of your recommendations, that parties like the DMK, the PMK, maybe even the RJD, possibly Mr. Ram Vilas Paswan's Lok Jan Shakti, that they could reject these proposals? They may turn around and say, Veerappa Moily has protected the excellence of Indian institutions, but he's done it at the cost of the OBCs who remain excluded.
No, that won't happen.
You're sure?
Yeah, I'm very sure that, you know, the inclusion, expansion, and excellence, I will be in a position to give such a recommendation, all the three objectives will be achieved. I guarantee that.
Mr. Veerappa Moily, a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
Devil's Advocate.